One is Ecclesiastes, chapter 1 and verse 1. Anybody be able to talk? Prasangi Vavati Vavati. That was the first thing God teach me in my mobile. That's the vanity of vanity. Vyaktamo, Vyaktamo, Antayo, Vyaktamo. After my accident, that was the thing God teaches me. Still I believe the same. మా జీవితంలో దేవుడు చేసిన మేలు మేము చెప్పడం స్టార్ట్ చేస్తే ఈ ప్రపంచం మొత్తాన్ని పుస్తకం చేసి ప్రింట్ చేస్తే సరిపోతుంది. దట్స్ వాట్ జాన్ టోల్డ్ మీ, దట్స్ వాట్ ఐ బిలీవ్. ఐ షేర్డ్ ఓన్లీ కపుల్ ఆఫ్ థింగ్స్. దట్స్ ఎ చైన్ ఆఫ్ యాక్షన్స్ గాడ్ డూయింగ్ వన్ బై వన్, వన్ బై వన్, వన్ బై వన్, డే బై డే, మంత్ బై మంత్, వీక్ బై, ఇయర్స్ అండ్ ఇయర్స్. గాడ్ టీచెస్ ఇన్ మెనీ వేస్ అండ్ వి కీప్ లెర్నింగ్ అండ్ through Bible studies and our community, within the community, we became strength. Thanks for the opportunity. Thank you.
Shall we all gather together and pray for the family now? Just join me as we pray for the family. Loving Father, we thank you, Lord. We thank you for your faithfulness. You are a faithful God. Your faithfulness is from generation to generation, and it's from everlasting to everlasting. Lord, we've heard the testimony, we've heard the life story. Lord, we've heard what you do, and what you can do, and what you want to do, and what you will do, nevertheless. Lord, you've done marvelous things in this life, in the life of Anand and Manju and his family. Lord, we bless you, we thank you, Lord. And we just want to come in into your loving care. Lord, the story is not ended. Lord, and your faithfulness is needed every hour. We need you, Lord. We need you every hour. Every hour we need you. You are our one defender. You are our righteousness. Lord, we come in them into your loving care. Lord, as Ryan is growing, Lord, I pray that he may be able to grow in your favor, in the favor of God, and in the favor of men as well. Lord, bless this family, Lord, and help them to grow, and help them to see your glory in their life. Lord, I come to them into loving them, and thank you and bless you. In Jesus' most precious name we pray. Amen. Amen. Testimony that you have shared with us. It's amazing. Amazing to know. And especially as Anand has read this verse in John's Gospel, if everything was to be written, if all the miracles the Lord has done to be written, the whole world is not enough to be able to record and then be able to make it available to us. And I had the privilege of being with these families, and particularly with Anand and Manju. And as we see quite a few things happen, the struggles that they go through and things that happen in their lives, and the decisions, the big decisions that they take in their lives and so on, I have this special privilege of going through with them in their journey and understand a little bit more And when I see what the Lord does in these lives, I can't believe sometimes. I can't believe the Lord does care about even the smallest of these things and so on. And how everything works together, as Manju is clearly telling us. You can do so much and so many other things. Just work together as we submit ourselves unto His will, and then pray, and then wait for Him to intervene in our lives. This is one family, as I closely observed and seen. God working in the lives. And I don't think we need any further talk or sermon or anything, but I just want to show you a couple of verses and then close. We don't have too much time, but we just quickly look at a couple of things and then close today. I just want to read this particular story, which is there on the screen here as well. This is the story of how Jesus intervenes in the lives of nobodies, people who are left by the whole world. The story starts this way. Jesus was on the way to Jerusalem, and he was passing by along the border between Samaria and Galilee, that is the map, and as he entered a village, he was met by 10 lepers who stood at a distance, and they raised their voices and called out, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. Have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were miraculously healed and made clean. One of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, glorifying and praising and honoring God with a loud voice, and he lay face downward at Jesus' feet, thanking him over and over. He was a Samaritan. Then Jesus asked, "Were not 10 of you cleansed? Where are the other 9? Was there no one found to return and to give thanks and praise to God except this foreigner?" Jesus said to him, "Get up and go on your way. Your faith, which is your personal trust in me and your confidence in God's power, has restored you to health." That's the story. That's what happened when Jesus was walking on the earth. If you go back to the Bible, you will find so many miracles like that. And one of the things that we know for sure, not only from the Bible, but also from the other writings, the Jewish historians and the Roman historians and many other sources, one thing is established: Jesus was known for his miracles that he performed, and many, many things he did, and many things within that 3 and 3.5 years he performed. And we've just now read, if all the things that he had done were to be written, and we find no way to write all of them. And he did so many things. He was known for his miracles. And his miracles can be divided into two categories. One category is the miracles that he did on people. We know so many things. This is one of those. And he healed people. And he intervened in the lives. One of the things that he did, and at that time, this kind of miracles of healing someone is not unknown. Those healings were happening by others as well. That's why in Mark's gospel you will find Jesus asked, "By whose power are you doing these miracles?" We know other people were also doing some miracles, but you are also doing these miracles. But whose power are you doing those miracles? Are you doing in the name of Beelzebub, which is Satan, or are you doing in the name of God? Just a pointer here. Many of us are running after miracles, but be careful. On whose power are you doing the miracles? But the miracles Jesus did were unique in that no one else in the history of the world, as we understand, and the records known to us, has done this kind of miracles. And that's why I said his miracles can be categorized into two categories. Number one, the miracles he did on people. And there were many healings and other things that other people did. But one miracle which is extraordinary is every funeral he attended, there was no funeral. The funeral was cancelled because the man was alive. And the funeral processions need to stop, and nobody did these things. And one extraordinary miracle, as you know, he went to a tomb where a man was buried for 4 days. And even the relatives begged, don't touch that body, it's going to smell, it's a rotten body. Don't touch it. We don't want to open this grave now. But Jesus said, believe me, you will see the glory of God. And we know the story, how the man walked out in tomb clothing, burial clothing. And how Jesus said, release him, let him go, give him some food. And these are the miracles done on men, people. But the other miracles, no one else did. The miracles done on things. You know, while he was on a boat, there was a storm. And he just told the wind and waves to shut up. In our Bibles, there's a polite way, calm down and things like that. Those are the kind of translations. But what he actually said was, muzzle up. Stop it. You don't have to behave like, as in, you know, the dogs come up and then jump on you and then you dirty yourself. Stop it. No, settle down. We don't want to see that kind of. He ordered the winds and waves to calm down. He had the power over the nature. And when 2 fishes and 5 loaves of bread were handed over to him, he was able to multiply them to feed 5,000 people. Unthinkable. No one has done it. His miracles are extraordinary. And no one was able to do it. We don't have anyone who has done this kind of thing. And he was visiting one particular, what tree was it? And he couldn't find any fruit in it. And he simply said, he couldn't find any fruit. And the following day, all of them found it. He had power over the creation. He had power over all this. This unique person that we know as Jesus did some of his miracles. It's one of those. And he was passing by, he entered a particular village. We're not going into details. Now there were 10 lepers who were standing at a distance, and all that they did was they raised their voices and called us one particular prayer. It was not a long prayer or any difficult prayer, just one liner. They simply said, Jesus, have mercy on us. A simple prayer. This particular prayer, if anyone is asking mercy, this is not one prayer that it will not be denied. If you and I are asking for mercy, he is sure to have. He is faithful and just. And every time someone asks for mercy, he is there to show us. They asked for mercy, and he said, okay, show up yourself to the priests. And all of them were leaving, and they were going to show up to the priests, and they were all healed. But here comes one man, one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, and he started doing amazing things, glorifying, praising, honoring God with his voice, not inside of him. He was yelling out, he was saying with a loud voice, thank you, Lord, what you've done. You've done it in my life. I can't think of it. I couldn't imagine it. I have never thought this could happen in my life. And I thought I was gone for my life. It was the end of my story, I thought, and I could never come back of this particular disease, which is leprosy, and my hands are degenerated, and I lost my nose, and I lost my countenance, and I lost my job, and I lost my social standing, and I couldn't even enter into the village, and I thought I, 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 that's the end of my story. But now I see health in my body, and I see restoration in myself, and I see life back in my own body, in my being. And he says all these things with loud voice, as we've just now heard. One man. One man. And he comes back. And he lay face downward at Jesus' feet, thanking him. Thanking him over and over. He kept on thanking. He didn't stop thanking. It is not a one-time job, Manju. It is not a one-time job, Anand. It is a job that you do over and over and over again. That's what this guy does. He never stopped glorifying, he never stopped praising, he never stopped honoring God. I never understood this particular word, how someone could honor someone with voice. How would you do that? Praising, how do you do praising with voice, with a loud voice? Something, it is visible, his praising is visible, his glorifying is visible, his honoring is visible and heard. Everyone is able to hear. Everyone able to witness. It is for public. He is telling the stories. He is testifying in the public. And he is saying, thank you, Lord. And he is displaying his thankfulness. And here is Jesus' question, verse 17. One of 10 of you cleansed? Actually, I saw 10 of you. What were the rest of them? What happened to them? Where were the rest of them? And Jesus says, get up, I'm reading verse 19. Get up and go on your way. Your faith, your personal trust in me, and your confidence in God's power has restored you. Restored your health. Restored you to salvation. Restored you to restoration. And where were they? And I just want to point out three things and then I'll close. A great deal is told. A great deal is said about thankfulness in the scripture. A lot of verses I can show you about being thankful. A Christian is required to be thankful. God expects you and me to be thankful. Be thankful. Be thankful. It is not about how you feel it. It is not about your feelings. It is about being thankful. It is a requirement, it is a direct command from God. If we are not thankful, we are not obeying scripture. Thankfulness, like most of the important things in Christian life, it starts in the will, like they decided when they were in that hotel in the United States. It source of that thankfulness is in the will. We want to thank Him. We want to thank Him. We've seen so much in our lives and we've never been thankful. We want to show that thankfulness. Thankfulness in scripture is a requirement. It's not about, you don't have to wait to feel thankful, but be thankful. You and I have to be thankful. And I just want to, Akash read this particular verse just to mention to all of us that thankfulness is a requirement God expects you and I to do. Colossians 3:17. If you look at Colossians 3:17, actually 15, you will see that the peace of God that rules us, the peace of God, verse 15, let the peace of Christ rule in our hearts, since as members of one body we were called to peace. That is 15. It's only 17 here on the screen, but 15 reads, let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as the members of one body, as we were called to peace. And here goes, be thankful. Just a simple one word there. Be thankful. It is a requirement from you and me. As Christians, you need to be thankful. You know, when we're thankful, whatever we do, when we are combing our hair, be thankful. When we are cleaning the car, be thankful. When we are putting up a meal, be thankful. When putting up the chairs, be thankful. If you are a driver, be thankful. If you are a teacher, be thankful while you are teaching. Whatever the little jobs, big jobs, and what the thankfulness of thankfulness, whatever you do, whatever you say, whether in word or deed, do it in the name of the Lord and give thanks. For everything that you do, for the paper you are writing, for the paper you are presenting, for the financial, you know, the write-ups that he does, the profiles he maintains, for everything, be thankful. For every little thing that you do, for every little thing that you say, be thankful. That is the requirement. If you read it in the opposite direction, whatever you do, whether you word or indeed, do it in the name of the Lord Jesus. In other words, don't do anything which you cannot do in the name of Lord Jesus Christ. That cuts away a lot of do's and don'ts. If you cannot do something in the name of Lord Jesus Christ, don't do it. Anything that you cannot do in the name of Lord Jesus Christ, don't do it, because you are doing wrong. But everything that you do, every word that you say, do it in the name of the Lord. When you do the right things, you are able to thank the Lord. Your words, your deeds need to be accompanied by thanks. That's a requirement. I think it's John Wesley. He started preaching about Christian perfection. Christians have to be perfect, perfect people, perfect people. And everybody said, you're teaching too much. You're preaching too much. How can someone be perfect? We are all, you know, we are all in the making and all the big things we talk about, you know. We can't be perfect. Everybody said, okay, this guy is teaching an ideal too much for us. It's not going to be practiced and so on. But he, John Wesley, writing in a journal, he simply pointed how you can lead a perfect Christian life. And he pointed to this particular verse, 1 Thessalonians 5. Three things. Just three things. Rejoice always. Pray without stopping. In everything, give thanks. Three things you can do to be a perfect Christian. John Wesley. Three things to be a perfect Christian. Rejoice always. Don't be grumpy. Don't be complaining. Don't be murmuring. Don't be in a mood to say, oh, I don't have this, this guy has this. No, no such thing. Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. Pray without ceasing. If you're doing a door-knocking job, pray between the doors. Priyanka's interview, I'm picking up from Priyanka's interview. She said in an interview, what would you do from this door to that door? She said, we will pray. I'll pray about it. From this email to that email, pray. Pray without ceasing. It's good to pray. It's good to pray. Be in a prayerful mood. Pray without ceasing. And the last one, in everything, give thanks. In everything, give thanks. Things may be difficult. Things may not be going in your way. Things may not be okay, but give thanks. Give thanks. Why? Why do we do this? Why do we do this? This is the will of God. This is the will of God for you and for me. If you can't do this, you are not in the will of God. In other words, reading backwards. Rejoice, pray without ceasing, in everything, give thanks, to be in the will of God, to be operating in the will of God, to be a successful Christian. The moment you stop giving thanks to God, you are not in the will of God. There may be hundreds of good things that you may be doing. There may be hundreds of people that you're supporting. There may be hundreds of great things that you may be achieving and accomplishing and all that story. But if you are not rejoicing, and if you are not thanking, if you are not praying without ceasing, you and I are not in the will of God. When we are in the will of God, and actually I want you to read that between and after, it's beautiful. Don't quench the Holy Spirit of God and so on. When we are not thankful, we are actually not allowing God to work in our lives. Thankfulness, we're talking about the attitude of thankfulness. And here it is, Ephesians chapter 5, 18 to 20. Do not get drunk with wine, but be filled with the Holy Spirit and constantly guided by Him. Do not get drunk with wine. You all know that getting drunk with wine is not right, not good. And in the same way, not being filled with God, not being filled with the Spirit of God, not being filled with God is also not right in that logic. You know getting drunk is wrong, and you also know, that's what Paul's point is there, the writer's point. Filled with the Spirit of God is important. How do we know whether someone is filled with the Spirit of God or not? There are three things here. Number one, speak to one another in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, offering praise by singing and making melody with your heart to the Lord. That's what that guy was doing. He was coming back praising, glorifying, honoring God with his voice, with a loud voice. And he fell face down in front of God, in front of Jesus, and then he started thanking him. That's the first thing. You have songs in your heart. In other words, you have joy in your heart. In other words, you have gladness in your heart. You have rejoicing in your heart. There is happiness in your heart, in spite of these situations. That's number one. Number two, give thanks to God. When?
Always
is the key point here. Always give thanks to God the Father for few things, 10 things, 28 things. Yeah? For all things. For all the things. Give thanks to God. This is the second. The first one is the joy in your heart, the rejoicing. Number two, giving thanks. And the last one, submitting to one another. Considering other much better than you. But the point here is being thankfulness. Being thankful. Being thankful. One more word, so we'll close. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. What's happening here in this verse? What's happening? Someone is anxious. So here it says, don't be anxious. But in everything, pray. So you need something, right? You want to be married, or you need a job, you need this and that. Pray. Have you got a job? Not yet. Have you got married? Not yet. Have you got a baby? Not yet. We are still praying, and we are presenting our needs to God. But here, even before you present your request to God, thankful. When do we say thanks? When we receive it, right? We bring him all. This is the boy that I got. Thank God. Oh, this is the job that I got. Thank God. This is what I have got. This is what I got. Thank God. But the verse clearly says, irrespective, even before you present your request to God, thankful. Be thankful. In other words, as we offer the cookie to the little one, boy, girl, we expect to say thanks. We haven't given it to him. We haven't handed it over to him. And when he sees the cookie and he says, thank you, Uncle. Thank you so much. We have to receive. Even when you are putting out prayer and supplication, but do it with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. I don't know whether we need to be. Thankfulness is the key for the answers of our prayers, but Bible clearly tells us to be thankful. Thankfulness, that is an attitude. The last one. Be persistent and devoted to prayer. Being alert and focused in your prayer life with an attitude of thanksgiving. That shows your faith. Being thankful in our hearts shows our faith. Our faith in God. And I don't know, I was just telling someone this morning as we were coming in the church, somehow it's important for God that we have some faith in Him. When we go to Him in prayer, He expects us to have some faith. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. When you are thankful, when you are filled with thankfulness, when you have that attitude of thankfulness, you are saying, I have faith in you, Lord. I have faith in you. I haven't got it. I'm still working towards it, but I know that I'm going to get it. So thank you. It tells God that you trust Him. Your thankful attitude. Thankfulness is extremely important. And here is the story. 10 of them received it, but one comes back and present himself with thankfulness. You know the story? The last verse. Your faith has healed you. Your faith has healed you. And not only the healing that you're going to get, you're going to get health. You're going to get salvation. You're going to be saved. You receive God now. Not only what you've got, that little thing which is going to disappear, but you get God. The last thing, these guys were suffering from leprosy. You know leprosy? Anyone knows leprosy? You little fellows here? You haven't seen leper. Leprosy. You know leprosy? I read that book, forgot the name. Say again, sister.
Fearfully and wonderfully made,
and the gift of pain. The gift of pain. The gift of pain. You know what happens to the lepers? They lose pain. They become insensitive. They can't feel the pain. That's why they damage their fingers. They damage their body parts. They don't know. Even they put their fingers in the fire. They don't feel pain. So they, when something happens to their body, they don't know. That's the greatest problem. That's why someone wrote, Paul Brand is the name of the writer. If you get the book, please read. It's a gift of pain, co-authored with Philip Yancey. Gift of pain. And he clearly Paul Brand is the one who worked with the lepers in India for about 30, 40 years of his life. And his mother is still there somewhere in that area working among the tribal people and so on. And he did some surgery on the fingers of these lepers. And in the medical books, this is called Brand's methods. It is described as Brand's method because he is the pioneer and the father of doing the surgery on the fingers and so on. Paul Brand, he writes about this. Pain is a gift by God. If you don't have pain, if you don't feel pain, you wouldn't be sitting like this. The gift of pain. Pain is a gift from God. So they are insensitive to their pain and they are dirty. It is a bad disease and they don't let people, lepers, come into the villages. It is degenerating. It destroys you. It destroys your body. And here are these lepers with a great problem. And we are in the same problem. Sin degenerates us. Sin makes us insensitive. Sin makes us unholy, unclean. Here is an appropriate prayer. Have mercy upon me, Lord. Have mercy upon me. Here is a God who is able to say, your sins are forgiven. You will be made whole. I can talk about these three things. Think about these three things. Degeneration, insensitivity, and cleanliness. Uncleanliness, what sin does in people's life, what sin does in your life and my life. These are the three things. I don't have time to elaborate a little more on that, but here is someone who is able to forgive your sins. You know why? You know how he's able to forgive our sins? Because he paid for it. Because he paid for it. And he is able to say, I forgive you. No one else is able to say, I forgive you. And everyone got offended. But here is the one who is able to stand and then say, I forgive you. All that you and I need to do is to have mercy upon me. Forgive my sins. And he is able to make you and me whole. And some of us seated here, we have seen and experienced that cleansing. We have experienced that healing. We have experienced that restoration. That's why you and I are called to be thankful. An attitude of thankful. That's our calling. That is our need. That is our requirement as children of God. Shall we bow our heads in prayer? Loving Father, we thank you, Lord, for these special moments that you've granted us, Lord. To celebrate along with Anand and Manju. Thank you, Lord, for their attitude of thankfulness. Thank you, Lord, for they raised their voices and took up the microphone and being able to shout out what you've done in their lives. Lots of things they couldn't say, but they know, and we know. For someone to come up and then to be able to say a few things, Lord, you've done lots of things. Lord, we bless you, we thank you, Lord. Gratefulness is just not a one-time story. It's not a one-time event, but we know that goes on. Glorifying is a continuous process, honoring you, praising you. Let these three words may be the motto of their lives. These three words may go into the hearts of every one of us as we're seated here tonight. Lord, give us that voice to glorify you. Give us that voice to praise you. Lord, give us that heart to honor you, Lord, with our lives. Lord, give us that attitude, Lord, to lay down before you in thankfulness. Lord, help us to be thankful. Lord, help us to be thankful. We are thankful to every Tom, Dick, and Harry for what we receive, the most beautiful gifts from you, the gift of life and the gift of eternal life. Lord, how much more we need to be thankful. Lord, the scripture is right in its demand, in its requirement that you and Lord, we need to be thankful. Lord, help us to be thankful, Lord. That is our prayer for everyone who is here tonight. Lord, I commit Anand and Manju and Ryan into your loving hands, the rest of the family, the extended family, and every other family, every other individual into your loving hands tonight, Lord. The rest of the time that we are together, bless us, Lord, and be with us. We ask in Jesus' most precious name. Amen. Amen.